to Boys Bible Study. Merry Christmas, everyone. We're so excited to be back with you for Christmas in July. My name is Ash. I'm here with my co-hosts.
Scott.
And Julian.
What do you say, boys? Christmas in July. We got the Yule log crackling in the fireplace over there.
It's the most wonderful time of the year.
Since this is our Christmas in July episode, I'm so excited for us all to open our gifts we got for each other. It's the first annual Boys Bible Study Secret Santa. I got Julian.
Oh my God, let me undo the bow here. I'm going to delicately...
Well, you can't reuse the paper. Come on, rip it up. Come on.
Hey, a penny saved is a penny earned, my friend. Oh my God, what is this? Whoa! It's exactly what I wanted, a 10x14 gallery wrapped, realistic, pastoral, and idyllic painting. It's Monticello at sunset, and in the foreground, there's Kylo Ren from Star Wars, and he's shaking hands with Mickey Mouse, and overseeing this great union is Benjamin Netanyahu. And this is... just incredible. And
oh, I'm so glad you like it.
This is exactly what I wanted.
Aww, that is such a thoughtful gift.
I had to dip into my cut of the Patreon money for a couple months, but it was worth it. You know, anything for you. You're one of my faves.
I mean, this is just like, I'm at a loss for words.
Yeah, well, what'd you get, Scott?
Let's see. I got to open it. First of all, Julian, is this wrapping paper or is this all stills from the movie I Believe that you carefully printed out and taped together? This is incredible.
I wanted to make sure that every part of this was a gift.
You are so thoughtful. All right. Oh my God, is this... how does this even exist? This is all 9 of the Crossman production movies in one Blu-ray box set? It looks too good to be a bootleg. This is incredible. Julian, where did you get this? How did you get this?
Let's just say it's a very limited run pressing. All right.
Wait, does that have foster care on there?
Yes. And a drift. Holy the Guardian. Shit. Like, I've never been able to find these. This is amazing.
I pulled some strings. Let's just say some people got in touch after our Patreon episode. And I was able to have some backdoor conversations. And you know what? I would do anything for you boys.
Thank you so much.
My pleasure. Just to see the look on your face.
Well, I guess that means it's my turn. So excited. I love getting gifts. Okay, Scott, let's see. I'm going to unwrap. It's kind of heavy. Oh, okay. Oh my God.
Do you love it?
Scott, you shouldn't have. I can't. One of the original trumpets from the Book of Revelations? This is insane. I bet if I blow this, the sea will turn to blood.
Yeah, careful with that. Read all the instructions before you use it. But, you know, it's your gift. Do whatever you want.
This means so much. You know, I mean, I'm a musician. I've been dying to play the same type of instruments that, like, the fucked up angels in the Bible with, like, eyes on their hands and everything like that. I'm so excited to feel like I was there, you know? I feel like I'm one of the angels on the throne of God. This is incredible. Thank you.
I'm so glad you like it. I was nervous for a second, but I thought it would be good.
Look at the craftsmanship amazing. On this. Oh my God.
Yeah, look at the engraving. Like, you know, I bet a fourth of the animals on the land and a third of the fish in the sea are gonna die immediately. Thomas Kinkade's Christmas Cottage. Julian, who is Thomas Kinkade and why should we care?
I believe that Thomas Kinkade is, you know, indicative of the downfall of American civilization through his art and the fandom and commodification of his art. You probably will recognize his paintings. It's basically like whatever rich person who has zero humanity in their being. Like, this is what will be on display in their foyer. And you can visit, I don't know, just Google, like, Thomas Kinkade galleries right now. And they're in, like, faux small towns all over the U.S. There's one, I think the closest one to our location, Southern California, is in Solvang, California, which is a, like, fake Dutch town. It's basically like a Disneyland village.
You never went, Julian?
I've been. I haven't been to Disneyland, but I've been to Solvang a few times. Yeah, I don't really like Solvang, but I know a few people who do. It's just not for me.
How was the gallery, though?
I think at that point they had... So here's the thing is, like, Thomas Kinkade is dead. He's rotting in earth. He's worm food. He's contributed more to the sustenance of worms than he did the art world. But he... So his, like, whole thing is he's, like, a brand. And there's lots of videos online that will show, like, how he does his process. So what his whole thing is, like, take a photo of a rich person's house and put it through Photoshop and put, like, the paintbrush tool, like, paintbrush filter on it to, like, 15% or whatever setting to make it look kind of realistic but also kind of painted. And that's what a Thomas Kinkade painting looks like. And so what he did... is he was really smart in knowing that this was a type of art that would be easily digestible. A lot of people would be willing to pay a lot of money on these paintings to the point where I think you, like, you can go in this gallery and the paintings are so fucking expensive that, like, you have to sign up like you're buying a used car or something. You have to set up, like, a payment plan to get this painting. But then he, like, also partnered with Disney to make, like, these Disney versions of his paintings. And what he's got is, you'll find a lot of videos on YouTube of this, of, like, how he makes his paintings. And what he basically has going is, like, the suburban, middle, upper class, white family, Mr. Brainwash operation going on, where he's got, like, five or six, a half dozen interns working for him making these paintings. And he gives the final approval on them. And they're all doing it in Photoshop, in Microsoft Paint, in Mario Paint, basically ClarisWorks, whatever they can get their hands on.
The Mario Painter of light.
Yeah. And so, like, nowadays you'll go into one of these galleries, and the one I went into was because of, you know, the great merging of all culture. Star Wars had recently been acquired by Disney, and so Disney is a partner with Thomas Kinkade Paintings LLC, whatever it's called. So I got to see the Star Wars Thomas Kinkade collection, which was really cool because it was like the big AT-AT walkers from, like, Empire Strikes Back,
yeah,
and, like, the ACA. Battle of Hoth done in, like, Thomas Kinkade style, and, like, Obi-Wan Kenobi and Darth Vader showing off from A New Hope. Done in Thomas Kinkade style. And I would like to just make clear that I liked Star Wars when I was a kid. I can't fucking stand it now. Sure. So this was, like, there was, like, a level of ironic / Schadenfreude looking at this artwork. And just being
these are just like his regular paintings, but with Star Wars stuff in them.
Yeah. And, like, I tried to get a picture of the Obi-Wan Kenobi fighting Darth Vader one. But I was like, You're typically the only person in these galleries. So, like, a salesperson will be following you around and they do not like photos. So I had to, like, go across the street and try to take a picture with, like, zoomed all the way in on my phone. but, like, maybe we'll get to it later in this. This guy cannot, and whoever works underneath him or continues his, you know, work beyond the grave, cannot draw faces, because that fucking Obi-Wan Kenobi face is so fucked up.
Dude, this is, you know, I remember you telling me about the Star Wars collab, like, a long time ago, but, like, I completely forgot, and I'm, like, having, like, an existential dread, like, looking at this on my computer right now. I'm all the way zoomed in on the Obi-Wan fighting Darth Vader, photo, and I'm feeling the color, like, drain from my face. Like, it is such a remarkable and dread-inspiring cultural moment.
It's terrible. I felt a similar feeling when I went to Vegas a year after Trump was elected, And I, you know, you just go there and, you know, you have all these questions about like, how could this happen?
Right.
And then you look around and you're like, oh yeah, this makes perfect sense.
Right. And you know, it's funny, like thinking about this now you were just talking about, the first thing that like comes to mind is that Thomas Kinkade is like the supreme brand for like old people.
They're lined up down the block on Fairfax for the Kinkade Gallery. Oh, the fucking God. Kingdom Hearts Thomas Kinkade collab.
Oh my God, if Supreme did a Kingdom Hearts Thomas Kinkade collab. Julian, you are a cultural forecaster of the highest order. That is the acceleration of culture. Like, that's what I want to see coming up next.
We need culture to reach the end.
Yes, yes.
These paintings are insane.
They're insane.
You're combining, like, the aesthetic of, like, peaceful, like, here's just some land and it's just you here, with like the idea of eternal wars in space, and like that's just as comforting to you, and it's like combined into one thing.
This is like what another truly reprehensible artist was talking about when he H.P. Lovecraft, when he thought up the Shigaroth, which is like the creature that is indescribable in its terror, and simply like gazing upon it is enough to drive you insane.
Absolutely. Absolutely. No, that's truly what this intersection of art and commerce makes me feel. And, you know, it's interesting that like Kinkade is the painter of choice among a certain type of American, because that's the interesting thing too, is like you could call Kinkade's art, you know, the art of the common person or whatever. There's this idea of the common person, you know, who would appreciate like none of this bullshit art, just like, you know, something beautiful like Thomas Kinkade. But it's like the art costs like hundreds of dollars. Like for you to buy like a mass produced like print of something of his is like still like 300 some dollars plus to own this like Star Wars print in your house, you know? And it's very strange. And there's you know, there's something to be said about the like the Christian community that likes this. It makes sense why this particular intersection of art and commerce is like the favorite among a sort of Christian upper middle class cultural consumer, you know?
Yeah, because it's about aesthetic and feeling and not looking beyond that at all.
Right, right.
And there's like that element of nostalgia.
Yeah, yeah, right. And nostalgia too, just combining all that together. And I think actually like a lot of the really recent Christian movies we've seen kind of have that same feel and vibe as a Thomas Kinkade painting.
Yes.
And that like they really put the aesthetic first, and in a specific way where it's like, as long as you have the template for the aesthetic, that's all you really need. And you don't put much weight behind it or beyond it.
And he didn't invent this. This was like Norman Rockwell's bread and butter before him.
Right. He was Norman Rockwell, but able to monetize, able not just to be like an American, like a maker of American iconography, but also able to monetize that to turn yourself into a cultural machine a la Disney, a la Star Wars, things like that. Requires a certain type of finesse and like a weird way of viewing your own output.
And Star Wars, of course, is ahead of the game on that too. I mean, it was a big deal that George Lucas wanted all the merchandising rights for Star Wars, because the studio then was like, what? Okay, whatever, sure. And then that's like infinite money.
And that in itself was a pastiche of like classic sci-fi movies that he had seen when he was a kid.
Absolutely.
Pastiche is absolutely the operative word here, which brings us to Thomas Kinkade's Christmas Cottage, a movie that manages to embody all of the cultural nihilism or whatever that we've been, you know, discussing, and also has a sort of charming life of its own. It like goes past the chasm of like of cultural dread and like emerges out the other side, this thing that's like, I don't know, kind of fun. I had a great time watching that.
Yeah, not, don't get me wrong, this is genuinely one of my favorite movies I've ever seen. I've seen this like 6 or 7 times.
This is a Julian movie to me. Like, it's kind of hard for me sometimes to put my finger on what that is. This movie, Powder reminds me of you. you know, things of that nature. I can't really put my finger on.
Like Magic Man movies.
Yes.
And like a lot of those are like this phenomenon, Powder, yeah. It's like a movie... This like early, I know this is 2008, but it's very much like mid to late 90s. Like the white man, especially in Powder, it's like the whitest man to ever live.
Like literally.
Like will come to the small town and change everybody's lives forever. Where it's just like you see this small town and you're like, how did this place even like function?
That is absolutely the case with... Thomas Kinkade's Christmas Cottage. It is a biopic of artist Thomas Kinkade that was produced by artist Thomas Kinkade. But it's not about his whole life. It's about, you know, maybe a week in his life.
Yeah, because we can get into it later, but he had a pretty wild life near the end.
That's true. I would not mind discussing that. Yeah, maybe after we discuss the movie, we absolutely have to talk about that because it's very essential to this movie. But... this film is about one particular Christmas in the life of Thomas Kinkade. He's young in this. He hasn't found his voice yet as the famous painter he would become. He's still in college. He's attending college in Berkeley, California. It's in Christmas 1977. So in 1977, he's a college student. He drives up to his family's hometown of Placerville, where he reconnects with his mom and brother and... yeah, as Julian was saying, becomes the steward of an absolutely impossible town, a town where it's really remarkable that anyone was able to feed themselves, to be quite honest with you.
So it takes place in 1977, or that's where we start anyway. And the director of this movie, all of the movies he directed other than Thomas Kinkade's Christmas Cottage were in 1976 or before.
Really?
That's good. You got to find somebody who knows how to do a period piece.
Yes. He had to like hold on to 1977 for all those years just to do this movie right.
Nothing about this movie really like indicates that it was... there's no musical cues. In fact, the first musical cue we hear is like a knockoff Elliott Smith song. They kind of dress like 70s guys. Like a little bit Easy Rider when they're riding their motorcycle up to the town. And when they're in Berkeley at the very beginning, and when I say they're in Berkeley, I mean it's like a room that could be literally anywhere. And you hear helicopters in the background to kind of indicate that there's some kind of, like it's either a big city or there's like social unrest or something. Mm. Which I mean, I guess it's just always in Berkeley.
It's funny that you say that, Julian, because when those helicopters started, I thought it was from either of y'all's background.
Yeah, the PSYOP, the CIA PSYOP of putting ADR helicopters in movies.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's supposed to be a mid to late 70s period piece, but if I had to pick one aesthetic frame of reference for this, I would say... the beloved 2000s television show Gilmore Girls. And part of the reason that that is so strongly in the brain is that the star of this movie, Jared Padalecki, I think I'm saying his name right, played the character Dean in Gilmore Girls. I don't know if we have any other Gilmore heads in the chat here. I've watched many episodes of Gilmore Girls, but... this movie was basically just like Gilmore Girls where they talk a little bit slower. And like they even had like Dean playing like hottie young Thomas Kinkade. And yeah. I don't know. It had the Gilmore Girls touch of the fact that it's like everyone is like sort of, you know, hacking it in this like small town. I mean, in the Gilmore Girls, their family's depicted as pretty rich. But still, the vibe the show gives you is that it's like just all these pieces of a small town and everyone helps each other and fits together. But it's like... all you guys do is kind of just like banter at each other. Like it's really unclear like how anyone's working at anything. I don't know. It's very bewildering.
I just want to add real quick that I love the motif of the biopic produced by the person that it's about.
Oh yeah.
Stars like a very attractive, a much more attractive actor than that person was at that time in their life.
That's what I would do.
We saw in like, yeah, of course, this is what everybody would do. Cause it's like, remember in Gotti,
I was just going to say Gotti.
Yeah. The son of Gotti is played by like an Abercrombie and Fitch model. But then we see pictures of what he actually looked like.
Oh, it's so funny. Yeah. That's the thing. If you're going to do a biopic like that, is don't show the picture at the end. Don't allow yourself to do the side by side. Cause that really cheapens the effect. Like just let the imagination fill in the details. But yes, we have Jared Padalecki. Who else we got in the cast here?
Marcia Gay Harden. That's a pretty huge get.
True.
He's in tons of stuff.
Plays Thomas's mom.
Yeah, there's some pretty esteemed actors and actresses, people of acting in this movie.
We also have the legendary Peter O'Toole.
Yeah.
Standout actor in this film.
Given it his all in this movie.
He holds this film together. This film would be nothing without him.
I can't tell if he's given it his all or giving nothing. Just because he's got that. I mean, you'll see if you watch this movie, dear listener. But it's like.
Yeah, dear listener who watches all of these movies.
Yeah. It's like the most actor-y acting you will ever see in a film. But it works.
Can everyone one by one do our best Peter O'Toole as Glenn impression?
Thomas, kill me, please.
I would say, Nicole, give me your hand.
Nicole, give me your hand.
I've finally seen the light.
I was painting the leaves of the forest and never saw the light of the sky behind it. Now I see it. That's all I need to see now.
Yeah, I love the part where he's like, oh, there's so many good quotes. I'm just going to pipe in a couple right now. I wrote some of them down, but I love the part where he's like, don't make art about the artist, Thomas. Don't make art about the artist.
Don't reduce art to something that's about the artist. Art isn't about the artist. It's about life.
I agree.
You'll become more powerful than you could possibly imagine.
Humpty Dumpty sat on the wall.
Humpty Dumpty sat on wall.
Glenn.
Humpty Dumpty had a great fall.
Glenn.
There's so many good... That part where, yeah, they're just... There's this extent...
I know the smell and taste of dwarf.
Yes. Oh my God. You just made a click for me. That is who this reminds me of. It reminds me of fucking Benedict Cumberbatch as Smaug in the movie Smaug, which
no,
is
The Hobbit.
Well, there's also like three like Smaug films too. But no, you're right.
It was in the making of The Hobbit.
Right. Julian and I, dear listener, are
specifically the making of The Hobbit.
So yeah,
on
literally.
YouTube.
Okay, dear listener, just a word from the wise. You don't need to see The Hobbit movie. On YouTube, there's like a 5-minute making of clip that just follows like a Benedict Cumberbatch in a mocap suit, like slithering around a soundstage going, the king under the mountain is dead. And it sounds exactly like Peter O'Toole's performance in this movie.
I smell you. I hear your breath. I know the smell and taste of dwarf. No one better. The king from under the mountain is dead.
I have written down the part where he goes, I respectfully decline. My next visit to the church will be at my funeral. And he plays a character, Glenn, blanking on Glenn's last name. It's not on IMDb, but
Danzig.
Glenn Meadmore, I think.
big ups
to the man. Who plays Thomas Kinkade's sort of artistic mentor when Thomas was still college student finding himself, there's a couple life lessons that his mentor Glenn teaches him before, as the movie progresses, he sinks deeper and deeper into his like sort of sundowning state.
His Bidening years.
Oh, the man is Bidening out the ass, okay? He really, by the end of the movie, is losing us. But some of the important lessons that Glenn delivers to Thomas are at the beginning of the movie, after Thomas, you know, is back in his hometown. He's just left, you know, Berkeley to visit his mom. He sort of feels like he's better than these simpletons in his small town. But he gets offered this job, $500, to paint a mural. And he says to Glenn, oh, you know, I have to do this. He doesn't say this, but he's basically like, I have to do this gay ass Christmas mural. And Glenn is like, give it your all, Thomas. Show one piece of art can change the life of a
show
man.
Them the gayest village.
You give them the gayest village they can possibly imagine, Thomas. A very, very important life lesson. That's all I'm trying to say.
Real quick, I do want to introduce Ed Asner, mm-hmm. who is in a much smaller role, because I know we'll have a lot to say about the other person.
Absolutely.
So yeah, this movie has a lot of, like, not necessarily A-listers, but heavy hitters. Like Peter O'Toole, there's Ed Asner, who plays Glenn's agent or manager or something. His like, business liaison, and like I don't think Ed Asner really needs work. He's like a famous Hollywood socialist, which is why I always remember who he is. Just a general good guy. So I think Thomas Kinkade was offering a lot of money to whoever wanted to be in this movie, because mm-hmm. There were a lot of people who just those two guys, and like Marcia Gay Harden has never really been hard up for work.
Yeah, she's still working. Yeah.
A lot of esteemed people in this. And then we have... Do you want to introduce him, Scott, or shall I?
Yeah, okay. He's one of my favorite comedians of all time. Chris Elliott. He's
King.
He's, as always, he is Chris Elliott in it. And is delightful. But, you know, I think actually... some of his takes, I feel like they probably didn't use the most ridiculous take that he did.
No, I agree, and I feel like he had a lot of room. They gave him a lot of freedom in this, but they definitely left his best stuff on the cutting room floor. And I want to add that, like, I too agree that he is one of the all-time greats, a hero of mine. Probably the only instance where nepotism has worked in any field, and it knocked it out of the park in this one.
Yeah, with it worked great.
His dad being Bob Elliott. But this was, I looked it up because I was just wondering what he was doing in this movie, and I looked it up a while ago, so the details on this might be fuzzy, but this was done in a pretty big lull in his career between Scary Movie 2 and then Eagle Heart, which is sort of where I feel like he was revived career-wise. But, you know, I don't know much about him. He might just be a guy who doesn't really act that much.
Who could turn on this role? I feel like he said, can I bring my own wig? And they were like, oh, I guess so. And he was like, all right, I'm in.
Yeah, he's in the... This is one of the few moments... Like, this is a movie that takes place... It's a period piece that doesn't feel the need to constantly remind you of the time it's in through, like, musical cues or dialogue saying, like, oh, nice painting, but what are you going to do about the gas crisis?
Right.
Yeah, so his perm wig is probably the biggest reminder that this movie takes place in the 70s.
There's that part in the bar where he has that like monologue he says that had to have been like either improvised or just like written by him. One of you pointed out it was like there's no way that it sounded different than everything else in the script. Like it had to have been his doing.
We should maybe pipe in that whole audio from that scene, because what the fuck does it have to do with Thomas Kinkade or the movie?
You know, Tanya, when those photos came out, as president of the Chamber of Commerce, I got phone calls night and day, not to mention the organized protests in the street. I really don't think we want to go down this road again. Just don't.
That was art. And this is discrimination.
I'm sorry, you just can't run again.
You are not the boss of me.
Yes, but I'm president of Chamber of
the Dark. Yeah, well, I've got friends in this town, too. I'm not some little orphan Ernie. I mean, Annie. Ernie. You know what I mean.
I don't.
He still does his, like, Chris Elliott behavior in this movie, and it's still kind of funny, even with all the restrictions. Maybe it's just because I'm a sucker for it, but I think he does a good job in this movie.
I'd go so far as to say as we never would have watched this without him in it.
I have to disagree with you because when I saw this, when I first found this, I solely watched it because it was produced by Thomas Kinkade. And I was like very much surprised to see Chris Elliott in this.
Oh, wow.
But, you know, the Lord works in mysterious ways.
He sure does. This movie's interesting because, it's because it's about Thomas Kinkade's life, but only a week in his life. The movie pads out the characters in the town and introduces just all these like little subplots and like relationships between the characters that are just like really not necessary.
Yeah, there's like every character is like comic relief in this movie,
right? And they're people for us to watch sort of through Thomas's eyes. Like, yeah, he's this the smart guy, college educated guy who's going back to his town, and he's kind of just like smiling, like he's just looking hot and like smiling, looking at these people being silly to each other. Like, there's the aging beauty queen who still thinks she's the town heartthrob.
I just can't wait to run from Miss Blasterville again and throw the switch on that Christmas tree.
Tanya, you ran in 1974 and you won.
I know.
You can't run again. You gotta give somebody else a shot at that.
But no one ever did turn on a tree the way I turned on a tree. Not did they, Ernie?
And there's the neighbors across the street who are having a competition to see whose Christmas lights are better every year. And like, aren't they so silly, you know?
Your move, Big Jim. You're pathetic, Gunderson. You and your uptight, beady-eyed wife. You think you can top me? I'm Mr. Electricity in this town. Watch this.
I built this myself, Pat. Oh.
And they're all people for us just to be like, huh, well, you know, it's not perfect, but it's pretty charming.
So many digressions from the plot of the movie that part of me feels like this was just a generic Christmas movie that was already written, and then they just plugged in the Thomas Kinkade plot, which amounts to maybe like 20 minutes of the whole movie.
Which that would make it like the perfect adaptation of a Thomas Kinkade painting.
Yeah. And it's inspired. We talked about this a little bit when we were watching the movie, but it's quote unquote inspired by true events.
Right.
Which is like the most like creatively liberating marketing tool.
Yeah.
That like every piece of art is inspired by true events.
And I don't know how many people in general, like across our great nation, totally fall for that one every time, but at least now my parents do. So I imagine there's a lot. Like they are always sure to tell me that, like, and it was inspired by a true story.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And that's part of the, you know, this is another thing that I think is like Thomas Kinkade is like one of the big signifiers of the downfall of like our country. I don't know how else to put that, but this like melding of fiction and reality, in that like we live in reality, but we believe fiction is reality.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
No, that's so true. And that's why like this movie is such an effective piece of art. Like it captured the Thomas Kinkade spirit in the only like inane way that it should be captured. You know what I mean? Like,
yes.
It did
yes.
such a perfect job of embodying like the artistic spirit of Thomas Kinkade. It was just as like self-centered and pastiche and like aesthetic driven and totally shallow as like any of his art. And it was like magical, you know?
It's pretty fucking beautiful, though. I mean, I own a few. I have like a separate bank account set up that's just like solely like paying off the loans.
Yeah.
Just,
oh, nice.
For these.
Your Kinkade payment plan.
The Star Wars one.
You're a Kinkade annual pass holder.
Yeah.
I'm a Kinkade black card. Remember?
So let's, if you actually summarize the plot of this movie, it does not take very much time. It's very shallow. So let's do that real quick right now.
Thomas Kinkade paints a mural.
Yes.
That's the plot. Oh, and they get to keep the family home because he painted the mural, sort of.
Right.
It doesn't really make, there's not a whole like a lot of one-to-one connection between him painting the mural and then the titular Christmas cottage. Mm-hmm. It's such a funny name for, because they live in it year round. It's not just, it's kind of implied that this is just her winter home that they're trying to save, which would be a great movie too. The whole town rallying around a super rich person trying to save their second home.
The second home because they had to cut back. Oh, that would be awesome.
Everyone in Mar-a-Lago rallying around the MyPillow guy trying to save his winter home.
Well, we know you had to cut back a little bit fiscal quarter, but you know, we want to make sure
you should make that movie. You should make that movie. That's so good.
Thomas Kinkade and his brother return home to visit his mom, who's having financial trouble, and she's behind on the mortgage of her cottage. And the boys look for work in town to try to support her. He gets a job. Thomas gets a job. He's a painter, you know, so he gets a job painting a mural, which he initially thinks is very below him. But he takes the job and he meets the various people in the town and he paints them. He paints them in the mural.
He paints them into the mural and they fade from real life and they're trapped in the mural forever.
And they live in his beautiful, dark, twisted fantasy for the rest of eternity. They're trapped.
An FBI agent shows up and has to investigate why all these people are disappearing.
But the premise of there's many premises, you know, one that it's good to be selfless and help the people close to you. But also that, you know, people want to see themselves in art, you know, that the people are what make the art beautiful. The most beautiful, effective form of art is just to paint someone. And then they see it and they're like, oh, hey, that's me.
There's my store. Wow, very beautiful. I like that very much.
See, he hates it. Oh, well.
That's me. With Jupiter.
You see how friendly he is? I told you, Tom.
Look how skinny I am.
You know, it was actually my idea to have him paint the people that make Placerville so special.
I may not know much about artwork, but I do know what the public wants.
Very beautiful.
It's very much like the kind of art that has to be approved by the government. Or like the idea when like, oh, this part of town is so beautiful. The city commissioned all these murals to go up on these, like, the sides of these buildings. And it's always, like, the fucking crappiest shit. It's like a supermodel with wings, like, taking a bite out of an apple. And that was, like, what was, like, approved by, like, a narrow margin by the city council.
Right. There's also, it's funny because, like, there would have been time and room in this movie for other more consequential subplots. Like, there is what seems like it's going to build into a whole thing where, like, Thomas's mother, Marianne's, like, ex-husband comes up to support her. And he's kind of, like, a drunken, like, rebel rambler type and, you know, fast talking and blah, blah, blah. And, you know, they sort of have this, like, confrontation in the bar. Like, it's, like, hinted that maybe he drinks too much, but it never even really goes there. Like, it never actually, like, claims that he drinks too much.
He's kind of a free spirit.
Right. It just claims that, like, he likes to go to a bar sometime. Like, I don't know.
It's just that he's, like, not around for the sons either, though. He's definitely, like, a deadbeat dad.
Yet, as soon as Thomas called him, he came running.
It's really weird because he's, like, supposed to be, like, the 70s burnout dad grown up, but he's the burnout dad of like the 40s in this movie, I guess.
Right, because he even like fought in World War II or something.
He should have been like a greaser guy.
Right.
Yeah.
It's very strange.
I'm just nitpicking at this point.
Well, it's just like trying to figure out like what made this movie so compelling. And, you know, my second time watching it, I felt just as compelled by it. was that? It feels like a strange dream. Like, it does feel kind of like you said, Julian, that like the people in the movie are actually real people's spirits who've been like trapped there forever. Like, there's just something very like uncanny and like a little mystical about it. It's like Twin Peaks Black Lodge. It's like beyond all time. It hints at things that should be familiar to us. Like, you know, Jared Padalecki as Thomas Kinkade, his like long hair, like, vaguely seems 70s because it's long, but also has a very like 2000s, like a decidedly like 2000s hot look to it. And
I believe timeless is the word you're looking for, and important.
It's actually the opposite. It's very timed, but it's just that those times are from like two random specific like times in United States history that are like impossible to pin down. It doesn't look good or like natural at all. But
I really like that. I fucking hate so much in movies when they're like, we're in the past now. Everything is yellow. You're gonna hear all the number one hits from that time are all together.
That's true.
And we're going to see a picture of Ronald Reagan, or who is the president? Jimmy Carter. My favorite president, Jimmy Carter, next to the Ayatollah, and they're duking it out.
They're both walking down the town square, and Thomas Kinkade's painting a picture of them. So.
And he's fucking driving a DeLorean back to his town, and 9/11 just happened.
The summer of love, October 2001.
It was the summer of love. The Bastille had just fallen.
Is there anything else important, like plot wise? There's a big plot involving a Christmas pageant that, you know, again, takes up a bunch of the movie, but is basically just inconsequential. And like, it's just like NPCs, like, battling it out while Thomas Kinkade kind of just like watches.
Oh my god, that's this whole movie.
Yeah, it's very, very Last Ounce of Courage.
I would say that Last Ounce of Courage had a lot more purpose to it, though. Like, a lot more, like, they were making a point and they stuck to that and like repeatedly put it in.
I love that we're talking Last Ounce of Courage. I didn't really make that connection while watching, but as soon as you guys were talking about it, like, yeah, Last Ounce of Courage is like probably the more artistically viable, like, fleshed out statement. It's
narratively,
certainly, that's true. But yeah, it dares to go where this movie only,
where no movie has ever gone before.
I mean, this movie only like pawed at, you know, Last Ounce of Courage like takes it there and goes.
But they have different purposes too. I mean, the purpose here, it's like the idea of an aesthetic. They have to like translate the spirit of the aesthetic of the paintings into a feature length film.
Right. Yeah. And in Last Ounce of Courage, there's maybe a little more like dire consequences, you know, something more dire at stake. But the result of that is like the subplots and the characters in the town, other than the main characters, are a lot more consequential. They don't just all feel like NPCs battling it out while Mayor Bob Revere is, you know, riding around on his motorcycle. This movie really, it's about Thomas being young and hot, but Thomas doesn't even get like a romance, you know, like,
yeah,
a little bit. Like, there's like, he runs into a girl who was his first love, and also his like girlfriend from Berkeley, like, comes up to the town to like hang out with him. And there's that one.
Did they break up?
I don't really understand. I kind of zoned out, but there's one scene out of nowhere where like the woman just looks at Thomas and is like, "You don't belong here." And he's like, "I don't belong anywhere.
You don't belong here.
I don't know where I belong."
Like,
famous vagabond.
Yeah. Well, it's just funny. She just drives over from Berkeley to be like, you don't belong in this town, Thomas. Come back to Berkeley, where it's real, where shit's real.
Yeah,
man.
We've been dating for 3 months.
It kind of reminds me of that movie that we love, Echo Park. Park with the film, I mean, specifically from like 2015 or 16, starring Mamie Gummer, aka Meryl Streep's daughter. Maybe. But there's a scene where, like, again, not to get into it too much, but all the characters are supposed to be really rich, but one of the women like starts slumming it in Echo Park to like get away from her rich family, and her like rich ex-boyfriend finds her and is like, "This isn't real. Echo Park is not real." And that's how I felt about Thomas Kinkade's girlfriends, like driving over from Berkeley to be like, why don't you get out of this town, Thomas? You're better than this, you know?
That movie would be the greatest indictment of like white, rich white LA people if it weren't like done so sincerely.
Yeah. it's the perfect satire. It's another very like artistically coherent piece in a way that this was too.
Echo Park's kind of a Thomas Kinkade painting too, the movie.
It is. It functions as the same thing, but the problem is that like even since 2008, our idea of like stuff that's aesthetically appealing has gotten somehow less and less imaginative. Like a fucking Star Wars or a Thomas Kinkade rendition of Star Wars seems like a more exciting culture than the idea of like some rich girl moving from Beverly Hills to live in one of those like neoliberal like apartments that were built over some family's home and cost like $4,000 a month to live in, you know?
It's just the same thing. It's just like, the aesthetic is now like minimalism,
mm-hmm.
and like it's like a photograph of like a Monstera plant, and it's been like cropped into a circle with like a soft pink framing, and then like a white guy with like sleeve tattoos mm-hmm. with a farmer's hat is paying like $4,000 to hang it in his like barbershop that he bought with his parents' trust fund yes. money and turned into like a speakeasy.
Yes.
But that's the same shit as like the fucking St. Louis couple with like AK-47s because that's too cool. The AR-15s like protecting their gigantic like concrete borderline brutalist mansion with like 14 rooms that they've never gone into, hanging Thomas Kinkade over their fireplace.
That's so fucking
true. Yeah, it's just about supporting your vague idea of what you think goodness is and not thinking beyond it for one moment.
Yeah. Like, your class has afforded you this level of appreciation of art that is not accessible by anybody below your class. And, like, it doesn't mean anything because it's, like, solely what you visualize the art to be. I don't know. I've had like 3 beers.
Yo, same. This is prime
knocking me on my ass.
Yo, this is prime podcasting juice, y'all. We're we're vibing. Let's go.
Julian, I think you managed to put Humpty Dumpty together.
Again. I mean, who am I to fucking talk? I got like little figurines of the Noid and Roger Rabbit on my bookshelf.
Yeah, well,
that I paid $6,000 for.
Well. Listen, my fucking Funko Pop collection is just advanced by this point. So, oh my god,
you've just got the Lin-Manuel Miranda Funko Pop where he's like biting his lower lip.
I have the Chasten Buttigieg Funko Pop
signed from the book tour.
Yeah. Oh my god, the Chasten Buttigieg Funko Pop is absolutely the Thomas Kinkade Christmas Cottage prints of 2020.
Is that real?
I don't honestly know. It's one of those things on the internet.
He's holding a copy of his memoir, My War, married to the world's most famous CIA operative.
Okay, I'm fucking Googling it. I don't think it exists. It's a custom Funko Pop that someone made, and it kind of went viral. It's, oh my god, yeah, it's so funny. It's sold on Etsy. Anyway, let's wrap up talking about just some main themes and impressions of Christmas Cottage before we give it our final rating. I would say one thing I wanted to bring up that one of you said when we were talking is the fact that like the tone of this film is like similar to a Thomas Kinkade painting. This is the film that people would watch and be like, oh yeah, this movie is like real life. This movie tries to emulate like realness in conversation or like the realness of a small town, but it's like all actually really alien and just like purely aesthetic. Like the dialogue in the movie is completely insane.
It's like cartoon world. This is like what you wish your small suburban town was actually life. Like this is pure escapism, but like the recreation of a reality that never was and never will be, where like you can get into a fist fight with your neighbor over a fake beard and he can like put you in a chokehold and start punching you in the face and it'll all just be like laughed over.
Right.
But in real life, like, that would be fueled by probably, like, an alcoholism or addiction problem and, like, feuding over property line problems and a dismay with American life that would ultimately lead to murder.
There are a lot of points in the movie where it was so so trying to be the aesthetic that it was that I genuinely thought it was a comedy. And then the next scene, I'm like, okay, no, it's not.
Oh, yeah. No, there were so many confusing moments like that. One, like, dialogue moment that I found particularly jarring was when there was actually trying to have dramatic elements, like when Marianne, Thomas's mother, and her, like, ex-husband are talking in the bar, and he's like, a lot of water under the bridge, and she's like, rivers under the bridge, and he's like,
yeah,
ocean.
I read once that drinking was dangerous, so I gave up reading.
Still killing time, huh, Bill?
No one ever kills time, honey. But you can hold it captive.
You told me that one about 100 years ago.
Feels like 100 years. That's for damn sure. A lot of water under the bridge. Rivers under the bridge.
Oceans.
Just, like, insane. Just, like, complete, like, NPC, yeah. Like, psycho babble.
Rolling Stone gathers no moss.
I also wanted to talk about the theme of art and meaningful art. I mean, we definitely touched on it to some extent, but, like, this movie specifically, like, puts forward, like, various characters express views of, like, what makes meaning in art. And I wondered what either of you thought of that, if you agreed or disagreed, etc.
I agree with the don't make art about the artist.
Sure.
I agree with that, even though this whole movie is art about the artist.
Yeah, well, that's the interesting thing. Yeah, it's... I mean, I think that the way this movie referred to art about the artist was specifically, like, it didn't want to have art where you had to, like, know something about the artist in order to get it, or you had to, like, analyze the artist's works with regards to, like, you know, the context of his career, where you could just look at it and say, like, oh, this is a nice tree, like, this is a nice cottage or whatever. He wanted, like, Glenn, his mentor, and then also the mayor of the town who commissions the mural, is, like, very specific that they want the art to be, like, representational only. Like,
yeah, it's funny because he takes all of that advice to heart.
Yeah, and it just becomes his entire career.
Even though the advice from the mayor of, like, none of that SJW shit, right, is, like, presented as being a joke, he took that to heart. And that was, like,
yeah,
why he is such a piece of shit today. I mean, no, it's not. It's just, like, what he is. It's just, like, a fucking the most generic bullshit on earth.
Right.
Well, it's like, I feel like with art, like, the general idea a lot of the time is getting somebody to connect with something that they weren't thinking about otherwise, or realize that that's what they were thinking. And in this case, it's just literally, like, what's in front of you, what you're thinking. Like, remember what you look like? Well, you're in the painting.
Yeah. From the back only, because I can't draw faces.
Yeah. It's like, now it's good. Like, that's everybody's reason for it being good was, like, hey, me. Hey, I know that shop.
Yeah. Yeah, it was really funny. It was just, like, everyone's, like, goldfish brain. Like, I don't know. I think it had, like, a really cynical view of, like, it's funny because in the movie, like, saying that, like, you're too good to paint like that is seen as being, like, pretentious. But I don't know. I honestly think it's, like, really cynical to think that, like, the only way that real people can understand art is if they just, like, it's literally a picture of them. Like, I don't know. But then again, I mean, Thomas Kinkade's work is really, really popular. So I guess a lot of people do like that shit. But I don't know. I find Thomas Kinkade to be a very cynical faker in general. And
it's talking down to your audience. That's why.
Absolutely.
It's giving them no credit to, like, their ability to, like, think or wonder.
Which is funny because I think that, like, a lot of film in general is, or a lot of just art in general is like that. I don't know. I just, every time I see a movie in the theater, I feel like I'm being talked down to. Like, everything is just like, it's like in Scooby-Doo cartoons where, like, you can see that there's a trap door in the room because, like, one of the panels in the floor is painted a completely different color for some reason. I feel like every movie is just like that nowadays, where it's like, okay, this is going to happen. Like, check this out, you know?
Yeah.
And Thomas Kinkade is like a, I don't know, his art is the equivalent, the symbolic equivalent of that, you know?
It's cottagecore.
Yeah.
Oh, actually, that's it. I'm glad you brought that up, Julian, because there's really not much cottagecore in this movie.
No,
and it should be
not,
the most cottagecore.
Not really about the cottage at all in this movie. There's like maybe three scenes where one where they're like, you can't afford the house. And then somebody comes by and is like, we're going to evict you. And then like, we're saving the house. And that's the whole arc of the whole thing.
We should probably say how the house is finally saved in the end.
Everybody gets together. I guess they're so inspired by the... this is the thing that kind of pisses me off, is that this is a town where everybody knows each other. Everybody knows each other's names. Everybody can fucking be like, oh, hey, how's your kid doing? Just like at any time of the day. And it's like, this, how in the world is somebody like not able to like save their house in this town? Because you could just say, everybody give me $20. I don't want to figure out the inflation, because I'm sure $20 was a lot of money back in 1977 or whenever this movie takes place. But everybody give me $5. Great. The house is saved. Instead, it's like all this fucking thing where, I guess the thing is, she doesn't tell anybody that the house is being foreclosed on or whatever the fuck.
Yeah,
I don't know how houses work. I hope I never do. I had to like Google what a mortgage was not that long ago, just because I had no idea what that is. I didn't know that you could just buy a house and be like, I can't afford this house. And people will be like, okay, here you go. Just make sure you give us like $100 every month. And then you can be like, oh, here, come live in this. It's my third house that I bought. Pay me $400 a month. And I actually only need 100 of it to afford this house. I didn't really know that that's how – I thought that, like, my landlord had to have, like, paid for the house in full before they could be like, here, I'm going to put other people in this house. This is why we're in this fucking situation, because all of our entire country is just dangling by a thread.
Yeah, everything's on credit.
Yeah.
Something about Thomas Kinkade's art feels like complicit in all this. It's like, it's the weird, like, evil smiling face.
He's the greatest war criminal in the history of the United States.
Yes.
This is why I can't 100% get behind Adam Curtis and hyper-normalization, because he left out the like 3 hours that should have been about Thomas Kinkade.
Oh, along the mortgages though, one quick thing to note is that, The Thomas Kinkade's mom in it, she's like, well, the banks are doing everything they can. And it's just, you know, like she's like totally giving them the benefit of the doubt. And it's like, they could just not take your home. I don't know.
That's the naivete of like, and I don't blame anybody for this, but like people who feel, and I saw like a Facebook post about this, but like people who feel guilty about taking unemployment.
Mm-hmm.
That's just like something that we need to change.
Yes.
About our lifestyle, if we're ever going to survive.
Yeah, if you're not super rich and you take money for the government, you're like, oh, I'm sorry, I feel bad, sorry. But then, like, the wealthiest people just don't pay taxes or, like,
yeah, and everything
significantly get out of paying taxes.
Yeah, and everything's on credit to them, just like we were just talking about. Yeah, it's like, it's everything's just loaned off to a class that's like, oh, they can afford it, so it's on credit, they don't have to pay. And then they just charge it out to everyone else who actually does have to pay, you know?
It's right. Just, people would be like, can't believe that there's a COVID bump. And then there's these people who don't want to go back to work because that hardly pays any better than with unemployment, if not less.
Oh, yeah.
But then, the airlines get like billions of dollars, or the banks, or
then still
fill
fail
in the blank, whoever. Yeah.
All I do want to say that there is like a scene with a Christmas tree lighting. There is a big reason why I feel so much affinity for these movies, particularly Christmas movies. And that's because this is full disclosure. So just because I don't want to be outed like Mitski or Arca, uh-huh. But my dad back in the town I'm from is one of the people in charge of coordinating the giant Christmas tree lighting for our town. And it's like a big event where they have like a giant Christmas tree outside of his place of work, and they light it up, and there's like fireworks and shit now. They weren't doing that when I lived there, but they have a big Christmas tree lighting, and they have a big lighting of like a gigantic 100-foot-tall Santa Claus. And so it's a big Christmas town where I'm from. And I feel like that might be where this like deep-seated obsession, love/hatred / wanting to get stepped on by these movies.
Also, I mean, your family being Jewish, I find very interesting.
Yeah, that was a big point of conflict in my life, I guess, was that we celebrated Hanukkah. We weren't one of those Jewish families that like cops out and celebrates both.
Right.
You know how like a big thing in our generation is like, and I've talked to you, Ash, about this, like people in our time, they really love Halloween.
Yes.
And they're all about Halloween like year round. Absolutely. And all they give a shit about is Halloween. But like, that's just like another version of like, I'm all about Christmas. Christmas has got to be perfect. We got to prepare for Christmas. It's just like another thing. And I don't want to like say like escapism is bad, because I fucking have like a video game addiction that I will never, pray to God, never conquer, because it's so much fun. But that's like just it's, you know, it was Christmas for them. It's Halloween for us. What's it going to be for our kids? Gen Neo. What would it be?
They're going to be all about Arbor Day. Those motherfuckers are going to be planting trees everywhere.
That's why that generation, because they're going to be saving the earth. They're going to be planting trees left and right. We're going to be like, don't tear down the artisanal sandwich store. It means so much to our culture.
Yes.
And they're going to be like, fuck that. We're planting trees. And we're going to be like, this generation's gone too far.
Gen Neo's all going to be eco-terrorists.
The Thomas Kinkade brand will be doing paintings of artisanal sandwich shops in the future.
Let's talk about the end of Thomas Kinkade's life, because he, just like every good story, they all have to end.
I would love to get into this.
Please, please, go off, King.
And I do not believe that people should be judged by the worst of their times.
Sure.
This is a man who let fame and fortune go to his head pretty quickly. I mean, you can see, and I don't think that this was some sort of like episode he was having. I think that the warning signs were all there. But he was notable for very, not outlandish, but like one of the big stories of note with him was he went to see Siegfried and Roy with his mom in his 40s, and he was escorted out of the show because he kept yelling. He was visibly drunk and yelling codpiece at Siegfried and Roy over and over again. He was upset, I guess, that they were stuffing their crotches. Or he's just having some good old boy fun, I guess, at the Siegfried and Roy show in Vegas and had with his mom and had to be escorted out.
Jesus Christ.
In this movie, Peter O'Toole plays a man on the verge of his death. And he died 5 years after this movie was made. Thomas Kinkade died 4 years after this movie was made because of I don't know if he struggled with it or he just embraced a painkiller addiction that ultimately led to his downfall. And there was a lot of arguing between him and his girlfriend, who was half his age. His family and his girlfriend, who was half of his age, over whether or not he died because of quote unquote natural causes or because of his pill addiction. And then there was also like a big debate over like who would take over his company after he had died.
No way.
Between the girlfriend and the first family.
Would go to the good side of the force or the dark side of the force?
You know, I'm not sure. I think the girlfriend won out, which is sad because a lot of his paintings have the letter N hidden in them, and the date that he was married to Nanette, which is where the N comes from, and is also the blonde woman that he, we get like a weird voiceover telling us that that was his first girlfriend when he runs into her in the movie. Even though I don't think they really reconnect in the movie, but it was important to him enough in 2008 to make note that this is like the woman he would marry.
Well, she also co-produced the film.
Yeah. Oh. So who knows? Maybe she was pulling some strings. But he fell into the dark side pretty heavily shortly after this movie came out. There's a really funny behind the scenes doc on the DVD for this movie where he spends the day as an extra in the film and is put in like hair and makeup and made to look kind of like a biker guy. And he's so excited to walk around and prank people. But his idea of a prank is the fact that he looks nothing like Thomas Kinkade, and he'll go around talking to people like a regular person. And then he'll walk away and just be like, they had no idea I was Thomas Kinkade.
This guy's a fucking monster.
And that's like his version of punked. If you look at him, like the year of his death and slightly before that, he was going through a big, like Ed Hardy affliction phase, down to wearing like those crazy, like Axl Rose style cowboy hats that are like way too small. And the like sides are like pinned to the top part, and really into like necklaces and bracelets with skulls on them. Which is sad because not too much after that, he would become nothing but a skull himself. A skull and crossbones, because he died.
Beautiful.
Yeah, he had quite the midlife crisis. And the thing about midlife crisis is when you're like super rich and nobody tells you no, you just die.
Right.
You either die or you become powerful beyond your wildest dreams. Right.
Which he did both. God bless him.
Yeah, and I mean, now who knows what kind of, like, this might be, like, the power of his spirit is pushing us towards faster and faster towards these dark days.
Julian, do you think if he had made actual art instead of what he did do with his life, that he would have had that same midlife crisis?
I don't think that he was ever capable of. I think he's the Antichrist.
Yeah.
I think he's the harbinger of all doom.
Oh.
Yeah. I think he's just a, you know, he's like if Adolf Hitler just like stuck with art, this is where we'd be. Yeah, just one last little note is that Thomas Kinkade, most important thing you got to know is that there's a guy from the 18th, 19th century, a painter, a British, English romantic painter. J.M.W. Turner, who is, you know, his paintings aren't that bad. And he was known not by his own, like, self-anointment. He was known as the painter of light. And all you got to know is that Thomas Kinkade decided that he himself was the painter of light, and he trademarked that phrase.
Amazing.
And Kevin Sorbo said, let there be light.
There you go. It's all connected. I'm looking at Thomas Kinkade's website right now. It's one of those sites where you go on there and it has a little thing that pops up, and it's a little lantern, of course, because it's Thomas Kinkade, and a bot is like, hello, don't be shy. Would you like some help? So it's just like already like preying on like old people to just be like, where do I give you money? And if the Star Wars thing didn't upset you enough, he has impressions of Israel next to Mickey and Minnie art.
Are you kidding me?
And like the Indy 500 and then DC superhero fine art, which are all just like, they're just Thomas Kinkade paintings where now there's like Wonder Woman and fucking Jabroni Man fighting each other in front of Big Ben. And that's like all it is. It's very sad. It's very sad, disturbing, funny. It's all of the emotions at once, all the feels at once.
And that is exactly how I felt watching Thomas Kinkade's Christmas Cottage, a movie so iconic that it defined the end of culture.
All right. I'm done. I'm out.
Let's,
I'm not out, but I'm out.
That was great. You know so much about Thomas Kinkade. I honestly had no idea. Yeah. Like, it's really impressive.
Sickening. This is what I'm going to be fucking when I'm like
just gone with dementia. So many holes in my brain. This is all I'm going to be able to talk about. So I just have no control over my brain anymore.
But you'll be able to discuss Thomas Kinkade's biography in detail.
Yeah.
Boys, let's take this thing home. Let's decide once and for all, how did we, Boys Bible Study, feel about Thomas Kinkade's Christmas Cottage?
Greatest movie ever made. I'll give it 1,000 points of light out of 1,000 points of light.
Lovely.
A lot of things about this movie frustrated me. While I was watching it, I thought, like, what does this have to do with the plot? What does this have to do with the plot? But then when the movie wrapped up, I realized that I was just, like, looking for the wrong thing. And what the movie does perfectly is encapsulate the idea of the aesthetic behind Thomas Kinkade paintings. And once I realized that, I realized it's a perfect film. I'm going to give this movie 1977 out of 2008.
I myself thought that, this is a really complicated and rewarding film. You know, just like maybe meeting someone in a small town on its surface. You might think that it's simple, but you would be wrong. You would be pretentious and self-centered, and actually below the surface, there's an ocean of meaning. I'm going to give this film $3,000 out of $3,000 short of the mortgage. Such ends the Boys Bible Study official review of Thomas Kinkade's Christmas Cottage. Thanks for joining us on our Christmas in July episode. Just some plugs from our end. If you enjoy our free episodes and like what we do, we would love it if you would check out patreon.com/boysbiblestudy. And if you sign up on there at the $5 tier or more, we make you 2+ bonus episodes every month. And we also like to do monthly live streams, which is very fun. We really enjoy getting recommendations from our listeners. If you have an idea for a movie you'd like us to review, leave a 5-star review on our iTunes page. Let us know what you think about the pod. Tell us what you want us to review. And if we have time, we've already done a couple. So if we like your idea, we'll definitely do an episode on it. Our outro is the song Oh My God by Mary. And from all of us here at Boys Bible Study, myself, Ash, my co-hosts, Scott and Julian, we would like to say Merry Christmas and peace be with you.
Forgive me, Father, for I have sinned. I feel your love in me, it's coming from within.
Oh my God,
my devotion is so unwavering. Divine emotions when you enter me.
Every day you take.